We continue now at the top of Daf Kufnun Hayam and Vezim Masechet Shabbos. This is Shabbos Daf 155b. The Gemara in the previous Amud had a machlokas between Rav Huna and Rav Yehuda. What is prohibited to do for an animal on Shabbos in terms of preparing food? According to Rav Huna, the prohibition is you're not allowed to create food on Shabbos, something that's not considered a food, and you make it fitting for the animal to eat. You make it into a food, that's going to be a problem. Whereas, according to Rav Yehuda, it's the opposite. If it's already a food, then you have a problem of tarchinan ba'ochla. Once it's already a food, we're not going to allow you to do further things to prepare it better because there's no point to doing that. It's already food. So that's what's not allowed. But to create a food, if you have something that's not yet a food and you're making it edible for the animal, that is okay. So that was Machlokas Rav Huna and Rav Yehuda. And now the Gemara is asking from the Mishnah later on Daf Kufnun Vavam and Beis a question on Rav Yehuda. The Mishnah says, "Mechatchin es adiluin lifnei habehema." A person can cut up gourds in front of an animal. Ves hanevela lifnei aklovim. He can cut up nevela. He can cut up a carcass of an animal in front of dogs, and he's allowed to do that on Shabbos. So, what are we talking about over here? My lav diluin dumya de nevela. Isn't the situation here that the gourds are similar to nevela? Ma nevela de rechicha after diluin de rechicha, meaning they're soft. The nevela is generally soft meat. The diluin also, we're talking about gourds which are soft. Alma tarchinan ba'ochlan. You see that when you have something that's already a food, it's not a problem to be toreach with the food, to prepare the food further for the animals. Or tiyufta de Rav Yehuda. That's a refutation of Rav Yehuda. Again, Rav Yehuda said that tircha is the problem. Amar loch Rav Yehuda, so Rav Yehuda will respond to you, lo nevela dumya de diluin. No, it's not true. It's the opposite. When we say nevela in that Mishnah, it's similar to diluin. Ma diluin da ashuna, just like the diluin are hard. Af nevela da ashuna, so too the nevela is hard. Vehechi mashkachas lo, how do you have a situation of nevela which is hard? Bevesar pili, we're talking about elephant meat. Elephant meat is a harder kind of a meat, and therefore the issue actually is to create, to turn it into a food. That's how Rav Yehuda will learn that Mishnah. Inami beguraisa zutri, or you could say we're talking about guraisa zutri, which Rashi says means inami klovim de ka'amar, the dogs that we're talking about, beguraisa zutri, they're small dogs, dechol nevela kashalhen, that nevela is always going to be a hard meat for them. So again, same basic answer, we're talking about food which is hard and it's being prepared, it's being turned into food. Gemara brings another proof, Tashma, come in here, the Tani Rav Chanan minahardoi, Rav Chanan minahardoi taught, Meforchinon teven vaspasta umarvin. You're allowed to crush up the, again, this is the straw and the aspasta, that's the grass that's for food, that's the grass that's food for animals, umarvin, and then you can mix it together. Rashi here says, umarvin ateven vaspasta yachad. You crush it up and you mix it all together. Vabhema ocheles hateven bishvil aspasta. This convinces the animal to eat the tevin because you have the aspasta mixed in there. So you're allowed to make this concoction for the animal on Shabbos. Alma tarchinan ba'ochla. Isn't this a proof that you're allowed to be toreach in the food? You're allowed to take stuff which is food and you're turning it into something a little more edible. So the Gemara says, no, tevin betiv nasariya. When we talk about tevin here, it could be a spoiled kind of tevin. Rashi here says, tevin betiv nasariya, the lochaziya, it's not fit to be eaten. Vahashta mashvi laochla. So it's not that you're being toreach in something that's already food. You're actually creating a food. And then Rashi just continues, vaisariya lav sariya lagamri. We don't mean it's totally spoiled. Dahi latina kaima vasur lataltal. That actually would be set aside for using as bricks, and that would be totally usher to move. That wouldn't be considered a food at all. We're talking about it's somewhat spoiled. It's still fit to be turned into food for animals. And then aspasta be ilizutre. Aspasta, we're talking about ilizutre. Again, small donkeys like we answered on the previous umud. So for a small donkey, aspasta would actually be a hard food, and therefore, again, you're turning it into a food. You're not being toreach in something that is already food. That's how Rav Yehuda will explain this braisa that Rav Chanan min Hardoi taught. Gemara now continues with the Mishnah. Ein ovsin es hagamol. You're not allowed to force feed a camel. Velo dorsin. You're also not allowed to be dorsin. Rashi here explains. Ein ovsin machilin oso harbe al karcho v'tochvin lo begrono. They used to force feed the camels. Stick it into its throat. Of a Gemara Mefarish Lashon Ovsin, Ovsin Lakim in Ovis Besoch Me'ah. Why are you using the word Ovsin? Because it's like you make a trough inside its stomach. Velo Dorsin, Shadoris La Besoch Grona Es Hasaor. And again, you push it in there. The barley umiyo lo ave kol kach demo Ovsin. It's not as intense as Ovsin, but also it's a form of force feeding. You're not allowed to do that on Shabbos. Avol Malitin, Ve'in Ma'mirin. These terms will all be explained. You're allowed to be Malitin. You're not allowed to be Ma'mirin. Esa Agolim, that's talking about the calves. Aval malitin u'mahalketin l'tarnagolin, but you could be malitin and mahalketin to the chickens. Again, this will be explained in the Gemara. V'nosnin mayim l'morsan. Now, also on Shabbos, you're allowed to take water and add it to the bran that you're going to be feeding to the animals. That's not a problem. Aval lo govlin, but you're not allowed to knead it. V'ein nosnin mayim l'fnei devorim. You're not allowed to put water in front of the bees to feed them. V'lefnei yonim shabashovach. or in front of the doves in the dove coat. That's the wild doves. Now you are allowed to put this food or this drink in front of geese and chickens, and in front of doves that are domesticated, because those are things you're supposed to be feeding. Rashi here explains, the Gemara explains, it could be because you're not responsible to feed them. They should go find food in the fields. Or it could be a particular din by water, because water is very easily found for the bees. These are basically domesticated. And they're called hardisos because that's where they come from. But these are domesticated doves. Those you're allowed to feed. Gemara says, "My ain ofsin." So first of all, what does it mean, the word ofsin? Amar Rav Yehuda, says, "Ain ofsin la avas besoch meya." You're not allowed to make a trough inside its innards. Again, it basically means you're not allowed to force feed the camel. Mi ika ke agavna. Is there ever a situation where you're going to feed a camel that much? The Gemara says, "In yes." Uchadamar Rav Yirmiyah midifti. That's like what Rav Yirmiyah midifti said. Ledidi chazi leahutai. I once saw a certain nomad, the achla kura v'atina kura. It loaded up the animal with a core of food, and it loaded up with a core of other things. Point was, he was going to feed this camel a large amount of food. Ein mamirin. The Mishnah then said that you're not allowed to be mamirin the calves. And then it said, but you're allowed to be mal'itin. That's what it said. Also said aval mal'itin when it came to the camel. It said aval mal'itin, and then it said ein mamirin esagolim. You're not allowed to be mamirin the calves. Aval mal'itin u'mahalketin l'tarnagolin. And then it said you're allowed to be mal'itin and mahalketin l'tarnagolin. So the question is, what do all these terms mean? So the Gemara says, Ezui Hamra ve'ezui Halata. What is Hamra? What is Halata? It seems from the Mishnah that Hamra is more of a problem of Halata. That seems clear. Question is, what's the difference between them? So the Gemara is going to say, really, it all has to do with force feeding. Amar Rav Yehuda says, Hamra l'makom sheini yechola l'hachzir. Hamra, which is the more problematic one, is when you force feed an animal in a way that it cannot return the food. The food is being forced down all the way into the animal's stomach. Halata l'makom sheyechola l'hachzir. When you force feed an animal with halata, according to Rav Yehuda, that's you're feeding it, but it could spit out the food. It doesn't have to swallow the food, so it's less of a force feeding, and therefore it's allowed on Shabbos. Rav Chista says, idi l'makom sheyechola l'hachzir. They're both situations where you're force feeding in a way that the animal is forced to swallow the food. The difference actually is that hamra, you're using a vessel for this. You're using a keli, so it's stricter. You're not allowed to do it on Shabbos. When it comes to halata, you're doing it, the person does it with his hand, so that's already going to be mutter. That's actually the difference. And so that is the machlokas amoraim here between Rav Yehuda and Rav Chista. The Gemara now is going to try to prove one way or the other. So Mesev Rav Yosef asks from the following brisa, Mahalkatin Latarnagolim, Vein Tzarach Lomar Shemalkitin. It says you're allowed to be Mahalkatin to Tarnagolim, but you can't be Malkitin. Vein Malkitin Leone Shovach Leone Aliyah. But for when it comes to doves, you're not allowed to even be Malkitin. They make this distinction. Vein Tzarach Lomar Shein Mahalkatin. And of course you can't be Mahalkatin. So one thing is clear, that Mahalkatin is stricter than Malkitin. So what is this brisa saying? So the Gemara says, my Mahalkitin or my Malkitin. What is the difference between Mahalkitin and Malkitin? Ilema Mahalkitin de Safi le biyadayim. Now, if Mahalkitin means you do it with your hands, so Malkitin de Shadi le kamayu, and Malkitin means you just place it in front of them, if that's the distinction, Mechlal de Yone Shovech Vione Aliyah Mishta kamayu nami lo, would that mean to say that when it comes to doves, you're not even allowed to place the food in front of them? It's the Rashi says, that's not even a tircha at all. Why would that be prohibited? The difference probably is that Mahalkitin means you're force feeding in a way where it's forced to swallow. It cannot return the food. And Malkitin means that it's not forced to swallow. It's possible for it to bring the food back up, that it's not going to actually swallow the food. So if that's the case, if the difference between Mahalkitin and Malkitin is this issue of Eini Yechol L'Hachzir, Mechlal de Hamra Bekli, that would imply that in our Mishnah, the word Hamra is a Kli. We'll see Rashi over here. Utuv to the Rav Yehuda. It would seem to be a refutation of Rav Yehuda. Rashi explains. El Alav, Umi de Mahalkitin de Masnisin L'Makom Sheini Yechol L'Hachzir. If the word Mahalkitin, which is used in our Mishnah, means that you're force-feeding in a way that it's forced to swallow, and Nami Shari, and that's permitted in the Mishnah, because the Mishnah said that Mahalkitin is okay. It said Mahalkitin Latarnagolim. So Shma Mino Malitin Da'agolim. So if that's the case, so now what does the word Malitin mean when it talks about the Malitin by the Agolim? What does that mean? Ugamalim, and it also says the word Malitin by the Gamalim. l'makom she'ini yechol lahachzer. It must be talking also about a place where it's not going to return the food. V'shari, and it's still permitted. Ela degabe behema kari lehalata v'gabe ofas kari lehilkut. Rashi says it must be all of these terms really mean the same thing. Eini yechol lahachzer, malitin, mahalkatin, they all mean the same thing. But by a behema, you use the word halata, and by ofos, you use the term hilkut. V'al karchach ein mamirin dekasar b'kliu. So then, what does the word mamirin mean in the Mishnah? It says you're allowed to be malitin, that's already force feeding in a way that it's forced to swallow, that you're allowed to do. So what's ein mamirin? That's got to be with a kli. So that basically is the refutation of Rav Yehuda, because it's implying that the Mishnah is for sure talking about force feeding in such a way that it has to swallow. That's not the issue. That's not the distinction. The distinction is whether you're doing it biyad or bakli seems to be a refutation of Rav Yehuda. Again, this is all from this brice of Mahalkatin Latarnagolim. So Amar Lach Rav Yehuda, Rav Yehuda says back to you, Liola Mahalkatin Desafi Le Biyadayim Malkitin Deshari Le Kamayu. Go back to your original pshat. The brice that Rav Yosef brought that says a difference, that talks about Mahalkatin and Malkitin, as if Mahalkatin is a little stricter, that is what's going on. Mahalkatin really means what we originally thought. Mahalkatin means you're force feeding with your hands. Malkitin means you just place the food in front. Now that was problematic. You had a kash on that because the doves, lemishta kamayu nami lo, you said, how could it be? You can't put food in front of them. Why not? That's not even a tircha. So the answer is, hani mizonosan alecha, v'hani ein mizonosan alecha. The difference is, if you are not responsible to feed these animals, you're not supposed to feed them. Even if it's not much of a tircha, it's still not allowed. Ketanya, as we learned in a brisa, nosten mizonos lefnei kelev ve'ein nosten mizonos lefnei chazir. You're allowed to place food in front of a dog. You cannot place food in front of a pig. Why? Uma hefresh ben zeh lezeh. What's the difference between a dog and a pig? Zeh mizonosav alecha, v'zeh ein mizonosav alecha. A dog is something that you're obligated to feed. A pig, you're not obligated to feed. Why is that the case? Rashi says, chazir ein mizonoson alecha to oror Yehudi sheyagadal chazirim. A Jew is not supposed to raise, he's cursed. A Jew is not supposed to raise pigs. Similarly over here, ein mizonoson alecha, these animals, these birds, you don't have to feed them. The shchichilu bedaber, they can go into the wild and find the food. That's the real reason you're not allowed to feed the animals in this manner, even if you're just placing the food in front of them. Amar Ravashi, Ravashi says, masnisa nami deka. He says the Mishnah actually seems to indicate this as well, because the end of the Mishnah says, our Mishnah right up above, Ein nosen mayim lefnei devorim v'lefnei yonim shebeshovach, aval nosen lefnei avozin v'lefnei tarnagolin v'lefnei yonei hardesios. It talks about putting water, that you're not allowed to put it in front of bees, in front of the wild doves, but you can put it in front of these other domesticated kind of birds. So obviously that's the same difference. My time, alami shabdahani mizonoson alecha, v'ani ein mizonoson alecha. The difference is, some animals, the domesticated ones, you're responsible to feed, you're allowed to put the food in front of them. When it comes to animals you're not responsible to feed, you're not allowed to put the food in front of them. So that seems to be a proof to this approach. Gemara says, v'latay mechmayer yamaya. One second. According to that, if that's what the end of the Mishnah means, why talk about water? Afilu chite v'sari namilo. Even when it comes to wheat, barley, you also shouldn't be able to feed animals that you're not responsible for. So that doesn't, if that was the distinction, we wouldn't need to limit it to water. Elashani maya d'shchichi b'agma. Could be the end of the Mishnah is a particular halacha by water, because water is something they can easily find in the swamps, and therefore it's not really a din of mizonoson alecha or not mizonoson alecha. This is, as Rashi said, there are two ways to learn the end of the Mishnah. Is it a general issue of you're not allowed to feed animals which you are not responsible for? You're not allowed to do that on Shabbos, or is it a din that's particular to water? Darish Rabbi Yonah pischa de venesia. Rabbi Yonah darshan at the entrance of the Nasi's house. My dechsiv. What does the pasuk mean when it says you are that tzaddik din dalim? The tzaddik knows the din of the poor. So it means as follows. Yodeh HaKadosh Baruch Hu. It's referring to God. HaKadosh Baruch Hu knows bekelev shemizonosav muatin, that a dog, it's very hard for a dog to find food. Lefikach shoach ilasu b'meiv gimel yamim. Therefore, gimel yamim. Therefore, the food lasts in a dog's body for 3 days. Kiditanan, as we learned in the Mishnah, kamatishach ilasu b'meiv v'yehi tamei. How long can food stay in the body of a dog and it's still tamei? This is talking about, let's say, a kelev ate a mace, which is tamei ba'ohel. So while the dog is alive, Rashi says there's no tumas ohel. If the mace is actually inside a live animal, we say that essentially cuts off the tumah from spreading, and the tumah is not going to spread throughout the house or the ohel that the animal's under. But if the dog dies, there is going to be tumas ohel from that mace that's inside the dog. So how long is that for? Bekelev gimul yamim me'es l'es. It says in the Mishnah, if the food is in a dog's intestines, it lasts for 3 days. That's me'es l'es, 3 24-hour periods. And so therefore you see that the food lasts inside a dog for 3 days. Ovos of a dog, and when it comes to birds and fish, kadesh atipol or v'tisarif, it only lasts the amount of time that you could throw this thing into the fire and it would burn up, a much shorter amount of time. Amar Rav Hamnuna says, Shvamina orach ara l'mishta umtza l'kalba. From all of this, you see that it's normal to throw meat to a dog because the entire idea here is that HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants to make sure that the dogs are fed. So therefore, it's a normal thing. It's derech eretz. It's proper for us to feed dogs. V'kama, how much should we feed the dog? Amar Rav Mari mashach unne. Rav Mari said, just the amount, the size of an ear, a very small amount. V'chutra basrein, hit the dog immediately after with a stick, because otherwise it's going to come back to you for more and more food. It's going to start following you around. And hani mili bedaber, that's only in the wild. Havol b'masa lo da'asu l'misrach. But in the city, don't do this, because again, the same thing. The animal's going to follow after him and cause him to lose a lot of money. Amar Rapapa says, leis da'anya mikalba v'leis da'asir mechazira. Rapapa says, there's no animal that's poorer than the dog. Again, same idea, hard for it to find food. There's no animal that's wealthier than the pig. Rashi says, leis da'asir mechazir shakal machal roilo. Any food is fit for a pig. Umotzi lechol aviaf machilin loharbe. He can find easily to feed. He can find food very easily, and you can feed the pig a lot of food, because again, the pig can find food everywhere. So there's no animal that's wealthier than the chazir. Tanya Kavasi, the Rav Yehuda. We have a braisa like Rav Yehuda. This is talking about like Rav Yehuda that hamra'a is to an area where it can no longer return the food. The difference between hamra'a and halata, because it says in the braisa, ezuhi hamra'a ve'ezuhi halata. What is the difference between hamra and halata? Hamra, an example of that is marbitza, you make the animal crouch down. Upokes espia, you force its mouth open with a hook. Umachila karshinin umayim bevasachas, and you feed it vetch and water in one shot. And the idea is that the water forces the karshinin down the animal's throat, so it cannot return the food. Halata, an example of halata is machila ma'umad, you feed it while standing up. Umashkin umad, you give it to drink while standing up. Vinostin karshinin bifnei atzman umayim bifnei atzman, you feed the vetch and the water separately, so you're not force feeding in that manner. That's essentially exactly what Rav Yehuda said. Mahalkatin latarnagolim, again, it's talked about the feeding of the chickens. Amar Abaya says, Amrisa kame demar masnisin money. I said to the master, who is the author of our Mishnah? The Amar li Rabbi Yossi bar Yehudahi. He said, it's Rabbi Yossi bar Yehuda. This is talking about the end of the Mishnah. The end of the Mishnah said that a person's allowed to mix towards the end of the Mishnah. It said, Benosnin mayim lamorson. It said you're allowed to put water into the bran that you're feeding the animals. Avalo govlin, you cannot knead it. That's the issue we're discussing. Who is the author of that line that you can put the water in, but you can't knead it? And he said, V'yamarli Rabbi Yossi b'Rabbi Yehuda. He said to me that the author of our Mishnah is Rabbi Yossi b'Rabbi Yehuda. The Tani, we learned in a braisa, Echad nosin es hakemach, V'echad nosin l'socho mayim ha'achron chayev divrei Rabbi. Rabbi holds if one person puts in flour, another person puts in water, the person who put in the water is going to be chayev. Just putting in the water alone is going to be a problem. Rabbi Yossi b'Rabbi Yehuda, Omer eino chayev ad sheyagabel. Rabbi Yossi b'Rabbi Yehuda says, no, you only chayev when you actually knead it together. Putting in the water is not enough. That's why here, putting in the water is not going to be a problem. Rashi says, Masnisin mani de katani nosin mayim lesocha morsin de nesinas mayim lo zehu gibula. Who's the one that holds that just the putting the water in is not considered kneading? So the Gemara now is saying it's Rabbi Yossi b'Rabbi Yehuda. But the Gemara responds, Dilma, maybe not. Dilma, maybe ad kan lo kam Rabbi Yossi bar Yehuda hasam el kemach devar gibulu. Maybe over there, Rabbi Yossi bar Yehuda says that kemach, which is something which is kneadable, it's something that you're able to knead well, there Rabbi Yossi bar Yehuda says you're only chayiv when you knead it together. Avol morsan delav bar gibulu, but when it comes to bran, which isn't something you really need, it doesn't go together well with the water, afilu Rabbi Yossi bar Yehuda moda, even Rabbi Yossi bar Yehuda would say it's a problem if you just put in the water. You don't know for sure that Rabbi Yossi bar Yehuda would be lenient in this case as well. The Gemara says, no, lo saka daitach, don't think that, the Tanya behedya. We actually have a braisa that says explicitly, a nosnin mayim lamorsan divrei Rebbe, talking specifically about bran. Rebbe says you're not allowed to put the water into it. Rabbi Yossi bar Yehuda omer, nosnin mayim lamorsan. Rabbi Yossi bar Yehuda says you are allowed to place the water in, so it is clear. The Yomid finishes with a braisa, Tana Rabbana, we learned in a braisa, in govlin as a kali, you're not allowed to knead the kali, v'yesh omrim govlin. Some people say you can knead it. The Rashi explains here, kali kemach shel tavua, this is flour, shenisiavsha, kishen kloyos betanor, basically it's parched flour, it's a burnt flour, veoso kemach liola musuk, this kind of flour, it's always sweet, vu kimcha davshuna, veoso mimenu shasisa, this is called kimcha davshuna, they make shasisa out of this, mishemen umayim umelech shemarvinbo, by mixing oil, water, and salt into it. This is mentioned, this dish is mentioned several times in the Gemara. So in any case, here we have a machlokas in this braisa, are you allowed to knead the kali or not? Man yesh omrim, who is the yesh omrim that says you are allowed to? Amar Rav Chista says, and we'll continue this discussion in the next video, and Daf Kuf Nun Vav Amud Aleph.